if you look at what the unique facts were that the prosecution relied on, it was a script of what Teresa was supposedly saying and doing in the bedroom. And the forensic evidence refutes that Teresa was ever in the bedroom. There is no proof she was raped. There's no proof anything happened in the bedroom. There's really, we know there's no proof anything happened in the garage. She wasn't shot in the garage. Even when the judge asked, well, there were shell casings. The response is, well, Judge, this was on a 40-acre salvage yard and there were casings all over the place because these people were hunting, shooting rabbits, shooting gophers, and all of that. I could tell when he asked that question, he's thinking, well, that shooting must have occurred in the garage, because in his garage on the north side of Chicago, there's no shell casings. But so you have to tell him that, because he's thinking, oh, there must have been a shooting in the garage. It's that misperception, and it's the opportunity to correct those things. And so I think if the defense had a better grasp of the facts of the forensic evidence, that would have been very powerful. And when the one judge said, well, why do we need two killers in this? The answer to that isn't to avert and not answer it. The answer is, I'll tell you why, Judge. The reason wasn't to have two killers for the fun of it. The reason was to take down Stephen Avery. They needed someone else to corroborate what the forensic evidence refuted. Just knowing all that, being able to refute it all, it's like there's this big tidal wave coming towards you, and you have to be able to knock out the whole thing. You've got to have an impenetrable wall up where you can just deflect everything they come up with. Everything has to be answered. And when you leave an oral argument and you have not answered on a confession why those are not unique facts, you're in trouble.